Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I am James Goodale. You know, if you've been watching this program, since 9/11, we think there's a direct connection with the computer and 9/11. Why? Because the computer enhances the terrorist's ability to commit terror. So we've been talking about terrorism. One issue we want to talk about tonight, which we have not talked that much about, is the financing of terrorism. How do the terrorists get their money? What do they do with their money? Now, our guest tonight says they're putting their money into diamonds to hide it. The 9/11 Commission, when it looked at the very same evidence that our guest talked about, they said, no way, Jose, we don't believe him, effectively. That's what they said. So we want to check in with the expert, the heck with the 9/11 Commission. We have him right here tonight, Doug Farah. And I want to show your book up to the camera, Blood from Stones. That's a great cover. It's a great book. Everyone should read it. And the stones we're talking about are just not any old stones, are they? They're diamonds.
They're diamonds, yes.
So tell us how you came about your theory that you thought the terrorists were using diamonds to help finance their operations.
Well, I was the West Africa Bureau Chief for the Washington Post, and I was going to Liberia and Sierra Leone extensively because of the conflicts there, and they were unusually brutal conflicts where the cost in human life and suffering was enormously high. And it became clear fairly early on in my coverage there that diamonds were the root of it. There was no ideology driving the wars. There was no sort of grand scheme of changing the governing system. It was about diamonds and money. And I developed over a period of time a good relationship with insiders in the regime of Charles Taylor in Liberia, who is the dictator there.
Yeah, there was one particular fellow. CB?
CR.
CR. Yeah,
CR. Cinder Reeves. Was the brother of President Taylor's first wife,
and he remained in his circle. Taylor, of course, was the president of Liberia. He was driven out.
He was driven out in 2003, came to power in 1997, had raised a really ugly war in the years prior to that. In the course of our conversations, he'd asked me several questions over a period of time that made me wonder if something anomalous wasn't happening with the diamond trade. But it wasn't until he had left Liberia, because Taylor was trying to kill him for a variety of other reasons, that we were having dinner, and he was looking at the Newsweek magazine that had come out right after 9/11 that had the list of the most wanted terrorists there. Right. I had taken the magazine because he had mentioned, I knew that Hezbollah was very active in the West African diamond trade. It had some Hezbollah people and the most wanted terrorists, but they were mostly Al-Qaeda people. I asked him if he'd ever seen the Hezbollah people. He said no. And that was sort of the end of the conversation. As I was paying the bill, he flipped over to the rest of the people, and he sort of went pale, and he said, you know, I know these three people. And I said, you know, you've got to be kidding.
What were these three? They were not the 20, though.
No, they were on the list of the 22 most wanted, and one was Abdul Ahmed Abdullah, a guy named Gailani, and Fazul.
And he'd seen them.
He said, I know these three people.
And what were they doing?
Well, that's what I said. How do you know these people, and what were they doing? He said, I sold diamonds to them. This was in October of 2001, so it's not very long after 9/11. And my first thought was, if you know, this would be an unverifiable story because it probably happened a long time ago. And I said, when did you deal with these people? He said, I sold diamonds to them this year, January, February this year. And I thought, well, if that's what he's saying, that I can check out. And so I went back to Sierra Leone and dealt with people who he said had dealt with them. They confirmed the story that these people had been there buying large quantities of diamonds. There was a lot of other evidence that this was something very unusual was happening in the diamond trade that particular summer of 2001, which all led me to the conclusion that he was telling the truth and these people had been, in fact, buying large quantities of diamonds that summer.
Well, so basically then you come to the conclusion that Al-Qaeda, because these are the photos, right, in Newsweek, right, Al-Qaeda must be in the diamond trade, or must be somehow involved in it. So how did you take the next step to figure out exactly what they were doing with the diamonds?
Well, my first impression was wrong. I thought they were making money off the diamond trade, as people do, that's what they were doing. And there's a lot of evidence, mostly from Al-Qaeda people who've been captured and public trial records, that they were interested in the diamond trade for many years and, in fact, may have made money in the early parts of the 90s to the mid-90s. In fact, what they were doing in this particular case was transferring their money out of the formal financial structure and into a system where they could hide their money in stones. Because you can move diamonds, you can move large volume of financial value in very small packets. You can put them in your shoes, your pocket, any body cavity. You can walk through airports and no alarms go off. Dogs can't sniff them. There's nothing hard about moving diamonds. They're also very convertible back into cash. Almost any place in the world has a diamond exchange. The United Arab Emirates, where Al Qaeda had their financial center, has a large one. Pakistan, where they were very active, had one. Jerusalem has one. New York has one. It's easy to turn these things back into cash as you need them.
Just slow down, because money laundering is, which is what we're talking about.
We're talking about sort of, it's a little different than money laundering, where you're trying to, it's asset hiding as opposed to laundering.
I was just trying to think how.
Right. Essentially, money laundering.
First of all, the terrorists, Al Qaeda, they get cash. We can get into where they get cash, but that's a big part of what we're talking about.
Yes, right.
We're talking about the end line now, but we know that there's a huge amount of cash that Al Qaeda has, okay? So whatever cash they have that they want to put in diamonds, so to speak, they take the cash. They might even take it by hand, so no one knows they've got it.
Right.
And they could hand carry it down to Sierra Leone.
Right.
And they give the cash to you, and you give them the diamonds. Okay.
Right.
Now, they may not be making money from that because they don't want to sell diamonds. Now they've got the diamonds.
Right.
So they don't have to put the cash in a checking account where it can be found.
Exactly.
So they put the diamonds all over the place. But where do they? I've always wondered, in your story, where do they put the diamonds?
Well, it's not clear. You can put them anywhere. That's the problem. And once, diamonds aren't traceable by geographic origin. If you sell a diamond in Dubai, there's no way to know where that diamond came from. They have in the most recent James Bond movie, the guy takes the diamond and says, oh, from Sierra Leone. That doesn't happen that way. You can't do that. The origin of their interest in moving their money out of the financial structure goes back to 1998, when Al Qaeda bombed two U.S. embassies in East Africa. It was their first large-scale attack on the United States after the World Trade Center 1. And the Clinton administration wanted to do something but had no idea what to do. And so, as sort of a desperate measure, they ordered the assets of Al-Qaeda and the Taliban frozen in the United States.
Okay, so that means if the cash went into the checking accounts about which we were just speaking, they could find them and they'd freeze them.
They could find them and freeze them. And miraculously, because apparently Al-Qaeda and the Taliban didn't understand freezing mechanisms, the Taliban had deposited $220 million in gold in the U.S. Federal Reserve System. The Clinton administration seized that, and that was gone. They found it, and they, after the Karzai government came in Afghanistan, they returned it. But that was sort of a thing of beauty. But in talking to people who dealt with the Taliban and Al-Qaeda financially in Pakistan a great deal in the United Arab Emirates, that was when that happened. Al-Qaeda, being a very smart organization and constantly analyzing what goes right and wrong in their operations, said, whoa, we're never going to do that again. So at that point, they begin moving their money out of places that can be frozen and into places that can't be frozen. And that's sort of the origin of their move into diamonds on a large scale.
I see. And then diamonds, then they'll turn the diamonds back into cash. How do they do that?
You simply walk into almost any diamond exchange in the world, and you can sell small amounts or large amounts, and it doesn't set off any alarms.
And there's no record keeping system.
There's no record keeping system that tells you necessarily who the person really is. Right. It just doesn't work that way in the diamond trade. It's a very opaque industry, and customer client privilege is valued to the extreme. And there's also no way, like I said, to tell where the diamonds actually come from. If you walk in, you can't say, why do you have Sierra Leonean diamonds? You just take the diamonds and pay.
Well, now this story, you wrote this story for the Washington Post. It isn't though you just made it up. Of course, you didn't anyway. But I mean, you got it in the book. But we're trying to establish the fact that it was controversial.
Yes.
And apparently the story was controversial with the CIA. Did the CIA believe this story?
I had, and it was a journalistic conundrum at the time, because I don't normally deal with intelligence agencies, and as a journalist, I had not shared information with them.
Oh, that's right.
But in the post-9/11 world, where I thought lives might be at stake and this might be of interest to them, when they asked me to come in and talk with them, I said yes. So I had several meetings with the CIA. They were initially very interested in what I was saying. Took a lot of notes, sat around with a lot of analysts. And then when it became clear, for reasons I outlined in the book, that there was information that the CIA actually had access to, which it chose not to use or not to access deliberately, and they were under tremendous attack for an intelligence failure, and they realized that this story would feed into that, that they just shut the door down and said, okay, in response to congressional inquiries, their line was, it didn't happen.
Did they tell you it didn't happen?
They told me the story was the biggest pile of horse manure that they had ever seen.
Do you think this is a great intelligence failure?
I don't think it's it is an intelligence failure, yes. I think it's an explicable intelligence failure in the pre-9/11 world because our mindset wasn't what it is now. But when they had two people walk into two separate embassies with a great deal of information about the diamonds for weapons trade going on, which would not have stopped 9/11.
But that happened the same time you were down there? When did that happen?
The first one was in 2000. That's before. And
right.
The second one happened just a few days before 9/11.
I hadn't focused on that. So in other words, there was a record that the CIA had been told the same thing you'd been told.
No, not they were the Al Qaeda.
More or less.
The Al Qaeda connection was not explicitly made to them because nobody knew who these bad people were. But a person walked into the U.S. Embassy, CR, walked into the U.S. Embassy in Ouagadougou, Burkina Faso, because he had heard that bad things were going to happen to Americans through the Al-Qaeda people he had been dealing
with.
Just before 9/11? Just before 9/11. And went to the American embassy and said, bad things are happening.
So this is your guy. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but
CR yes.
is your guy who
He's
told
my
the
guy.
Stories, the basis, in a sense, for the book. Not entirely, but
right.
it's where it starts.
Yeah, it's where it starts.
And you got the story from him, and then he went in and told the CIA, the embassy, before 9/11 that there was some connection. Something bad was going on. And
he told them on September 8th.
Oh, September 8th.
And they told him.
And what happened to that information?
They told him, thank you very much. Don't call us. We'll call you. Goodbye.
And so was that information in the CIA hands eventually?
They had it, yes, yes. They flew the
so
station. He went to the embassy and made initial contact. They flew the station chief from Abidjan in to meet with him. And the CIA got it directly from CR, yes.
Has that been reported other than in your book?
No. Although I have the minutes of their meetings and things, I have a lot of information. They don't deny those meetings took place.
I mean, this is just as bad as some of the other stuff that the FBI missed and everyone else missed before 9/11. Of course, it's pretty close to 9/11, but nonetheless.
Right. I mean, my feeling, and I didn't initially report those meetings in the Washington Post, because right. my feeling was that if they had mobilized everything and tried to figure it out, it wouldn't have stopped 9/11. So why embarrass them further? When my personal credibility came under assault by them and they began getting quite personal in their attempts to discredit the story by...
Well, what does that mean? You're being very nice.
they started saying I had made this up to sell books, et cetera.
Books.
I would call... I know a lot of people who deal with in the intelligence community, and I would get calls from people saying, do you know what the CIA is saying about you? And I'd say, no, tell me. And it was getting, they were questioning my professionalism, my ethics, my motives, at which point I thought, okay, you can question the story, and if you can prove it's wrong, fine, which they can't, but if you could do that, that's open game. That's, fair enough.
So,
but me, and my reputation, I felt was going too far.
So when the book came out, which is recently, what has the CIA been asked to comment, or is this going under the radar?
They have been asked by news organizations to comment. Their comment is that they don't comment.
Now. Their comment is they don't comment.
Right.
Well, now, did the CIA go down and interview CR after you talked to him?
They did. It was
what happened?
Was the biggest mistake I've ever made in my life, my professional life anyway. The CIA had told me that if any of my sources were ever available and wanted to talk with them, to let them know. President Taylor was trying very hard to kill CR. CR called me up and said, can you help me out? I made contact with the agency through an intermediary and said, would you be interested? And they said yes. They flew, and I told CR, look, they'll probably want to polygraph you. This is all by phone, because by this time I was back in the States. He was in Ghana at the time. I said, they'll probably want to polygraph you. If you tell the truth, there's no problem. They'll probably tell you you can never call me again. So essentially, goodbye and thanks. And so CIA flew a team over. CR called me, and this is a guy who's been in combat and seen.
What's he look like anyway, CR?
He's about a little over 6 feet tall.
Oh,
very
6 feet.
Thin, wiry.
And right in the middle of all sorts of hell.
Right in the certain middle of all sorts of hell. And he called me, he was almost crying. He said, how could you do this to me? And I said, do what to you? He said, how could you do this? Send these people to me and betray me. I said, what are you talking about? I don't know what happened. The story, which was subsequently confirmed to me by other people with direct knowledge of it, was that the CIA had flown in, had asked him to go to a hotel. These are two white CIA officers in black Africa dealing with a black African where there's automatically a little bit of suspicion. He decided to go and do this. They took his cell phone away, wouldn't let him tell his wife where he was, didn't say when he'd come back, strapped him to a polygraph and began asking him why he was lying. Well, he didn't react very well to that. So the interview went downhill very quickly, and he took the polygraph strips off and said, I'm out of here, goodbye, thank you very much. The person, the intermediary I had asked to set all this up, called me a few days later, and he said, you know, it's really strange. I called, you know, my contacts at the agency, and they said that one CR failed 17 out of 17 questions, which no one does, because you always get your name right, things like that. And they're very happy. They're really pleased that this happened. And I said, this is really strange. I don't understand
it. Now, this is before the 9/11 report.
This is before the 9/11 Commission report. Yes, yeah. Well before the 9/11 Commission report, yes.
So CIA has a lot of self-interest in making this story go away.
Yes.
Because otherwise the 9/11 Commission will find out about it, and it'll be known as one of these intelligence failures.
Absolutely. And they were also getting a lot of questions from Congress on this particular, on the diamond issue. So finally, a few months after this whole incident happened, my friend who dealt with the agency called me up and said, he said, you know why they were doing this? And I said, no, why did they do this? And he said, you know, I've never seen anything like it, but they wanted to discredit him because now when Congress asks questions or anybody asks questions, they say...
Well, they'll pull out the polygraph.
Well, they say we polygraphed his main source and his main source
was...
Absolutely. I've seen...
No, but has it happened in CR's case?
Absolutely. No, every letter that the congressmen get or congresspeople get from the CIA regarding this contains a paragraph that says it's a single source story, which is false. And we have polygraphed the main source, and the main source was lying.
When you say a single source is false, because you had other confirmation all over the place about
this story. I went to great lengths and risked my life to go back and talk with the people CR said had dealt with these people. I had six people confirm this before I wrote my initial story.
You went back to, were these the guys that are digging the diamonds?
I went back to the people who were leading the killer army that was digging the diamonds and said...
And what did you do, go back from Washington?
No, I was in Abidjan at the time, in Ivory Coast, where the bureau was. I went into Sierra Leone to do this.
And you confirmed it?
At great length.
Maybe all this explains this quote from the 9/11 Commission, which I want to... read you. This is on whether there's the diamonds are part of the financing mechanism. This is what the commission, it's a well-known commission that did a good job, so forth and so on. We have seen no persuasive evidence that Al-Qaeda funded itself by trading in Africa conflict diamonds. Those are the diamonds we're talking about.
Right.
Flat out saying you're flat out wrong. No evidence. No evidence. What do you make of that statement?
Well, first, I think they're answering the wrong question because I didn't say that they funded themselves. I said they put their money into there.
Well.
So there's the false premise to the statement to begin with. But the way the commission worked, and
Wait a minute. Maybe it's a tricky statement. I didn't have time to think about it because you pointed out at the beginning of the show that they weren't making money,
right?
But they were using it as a way of banking, you might
right.
say.
Exactly.
And so
they didn't
even answer the question.
They answered a different question.
And
the reason we know that
right. The answer to that one may be right, but they never answered your question.
Exactly.
But the implication is exactly what
yes.
I get. I mean,
I
looked at it several times.
And the other people have answered this question in the same way. And it's a really interesting use of language. But the reason we know that they weren't making money off it is because when they were buying from the rebels in Liberia and Sierra Leone in the summer of 2001, they were actually paying a premium for their diamonds.
Right.
They asked for a monopoly franchise from the rebels to buy as many diamonds as they could produce.
Okay, but the point is the 9/11 Commission is saying that go away, Doug Farah. Take this book, Blood from Stones, throw it in the East River or the Chesapeake, what river
Bay,
you have? Potomac.
Bay, Potomac
throw it in the Potomac, and because you don't have anything at all, and we're the 9/11 Commission. Now, why did they say that?
Well, the way the commission worked is that they went to the intelligence community and queried them on a series of things. And they said to the intelligence community, tell us what you have on the diamond trade in Al-Qaeda from 1998 to 2001. Well, the intelligence community had nothing. They had nothing. And so the answer
came back. So they find no
back.
Credible evidence because they talk to the people who says there's no credible evidence. And there's no credible evidence because they don't believe you.
And that's... And, well, yes, and they didn't talk to me until... very late in the process.
Who's that?
The commission.
Oh,
folks.
The commission did talk to you
briefly.
Where do they do that?
Simply exchanged. No, we exchanged emails over time.
If
you know, some of the, they were asking questions about some of the sourcing on some of this, and because it's in the book in the CIA sort of archive now that CR failed a polygraph test. When they say there's no evidence and we polygraphed the main guy,
you failed the polygraph.
They never
You failed the email polygraph test.
I guess I did.
What did you tell them? Just the same thing you've been telling me, basically.
I said.
And what did they say? You're all wrong.
They didn't say anything at that point.
Why
I didn't know what their conclusion was until. But let me just make one other point.
Yeah.
That there is a special court for Sierra Leone, which is a UN-backed organization investigating the crimes against humanity.
Right.
The lead prosecutor and the lead investigator are 30-year veterans each of the U.S. Department
right.
of Defense. They initially, on their way over to Sierra Leone in 2001, called me up. I went through all this, and they said, you know, we don't, you know, this is preposterous. I said, fine. 6 months later, they called me, and they said, can you come back to Sierra Leone and talk with us? I went to Sierra Leone, and they said, we're finding all this evidence of al-Qaeda from people that you never met,
right.
people you never talked to. What do we do? And I said, I don't know. And I went through some of their things. We now have at least 15 eyewitnesses to these people and other al-Qaeda people having been there. And these are DOD investigators and prosecutors. I mean, it's the person, the David Crane investigated John Deutsch when he took his classified computers
yeah.
out. I mean, they're people with long reputations and long histories who have no interest, no vested interest in this being true. They have simply been on the ground long enough to come to the conclusion that not only did this happen, but much more than I knew happened. So it's not just me. There's a.
But BBC ran a piece on it, didn't
BBC
it?
BBC ran a documentary. There's a very good non-governmental organization called Global Witness, which took my information and then went much
but
further.
What
with
I
it.
Don't get here, we have the 9/11 Commission. It's supposed to be looking at everything about terrorism.
Right.
It throws up its hands about financing. This is just the tip of the iceberg because Lee Hamilton, who was co-chairman, said before Congress or elsewhere, basically, we don't know where they're getting the money.
Right.
And you point out in this book that their annual budget, just sort of to keep the organization going, is $30 million.
Right.
Okay, so that means there's $30 million going to al-Qaeda every year. And Lee Hamilton says, we don't know where it is.
Right.
We don't seem to, implicitly, don't seem to have an interest. When you point out part of the
puzzle, yeah.
Part of the puzzle. I'm about to say funny mechanism. You would have picked part of the puzzle. There doesn't seem any interest. I don't understand why this is so. I mean, it's sort of shocking because the 9/11 Commission, which by the way didn't look into everything,
right?
But you know, it couldn't look into everything. But this is very important. I'll tell you what. I had an ex-Secretary of State told me that if he had been the head of this commission, he would have focused on this in much greater detail.
Right.
Okay, they didn't. But I don't get it. What, is there a mindset that's against
it
or what?
There is, I think, in, having dealt now in the past couple of years much more extensively with the intelligence community than I had ever done before, I think there is a cultural impediment in the intelligence community to accepting information that comes that they themselves don't originate.
Yeah.
And one of the people actually told me in one of my meetings with the CIA, he said, if this had been happening, we would have known about it. And I happened to have known the station chief in Abidjan, who had left by the time all of this happened, but I knew him quite well for a while. And I said, how would you know that?
Yeah.
You had no agents on the ground in West Africa. Yeah. You had one.
That's the problem.
You had one station chief in Abidjan doing three countries who told me what he does is clip newspaper articles and talk to a few contacts. You had nobody there. How would you possibly know
this? Well, we had Mr. Scheuer on the program recently, who's known as Mr. Anonymous. And he pointed out that the CIA doesn't believe any information that is available to it from open sources.
Right.
So therefore, well, that means if you went to Google and found your stories, they don't believe that.
Right.
But if they have it in their own internal system, they would.
It, especially if it's stamped secret.
Then it's stamped secret, it's okay. But if it's out there in the open, that doesn't make me feel any better. But here, let me ask you this. What are we going to do about this?
Well, first you have to change the mindset of the community. If you deal with, as I have dealt with the people who deal with terrorist financing in the FBI and other agencies, they still want to look at bank transactions and wire transfers because those are things they understand. It's very difficult. And in the book, I talk about other funding mechanisms as well, the hawala system and other
sort of the secret banking system where money doesn't really. transfer hands. Yeah.
Right, and it's very difficult for people to start looking at things that they have no cultural understanding of and no experience with. So when you ask them, they'll say, yes, we're looking at Hawala, commodities are important. What about banks? Because that's what they know. And so you've got to get people to a new generation, perhaps, or people who can look outside the traditional mindset, because they all want to view this as money laundering. Money laundering is when you have rivers of, for example, drug money, right, this dirty money that you want to become clean. You want to make right. it appear to be legit. This is the reverse of that. This is where you have massive amounts of legitimate right. money flowing to charities and other organizations, and you want to take small portions of that and use them for terrorism. And if you view it, if your experience is money laundering and that's how you look at everything, then that's how you want to deal with things. But it's a cultural mindset change that needs to happen to understand what this is really
about. Okay, now, the great recommendation, contribution of the 9/11 Commission, one might say, is that they came up with a recommendation that there be a czar who sits over the CIA, sits over the Defense Department intelligence, right. sits over National Security Agency intelligence, that's code intelligence, and so that a cultural change can be effected within the intelligence communities, because there's not only this problem, but there's a problem of having the intelligence community computers talk to each other.
Right.
Do you think we're going to get a cultural change because we have this new czar?
I think it's extremely difficult. I think that you've seen a lot of bloodletting already at the CIA with Porter Goss coming in and essentially dismantling the upper leadership of that organization. And I'm not sure that Ambassador Negroponte, who will be the new head of intelligence, will have the ability to reach down sort of into the bowels of these agencies and come up with different things. Let me make one other point, if I can, on this stuff and the intelligence community. There is one sector of the intelligence community that's been very receptive to this and worked on it and actually been very supportive of me both publicly and privately, which is the Defense Intelligence Establishment. Because they have people on the ground in these countries, and they actually have, in places like West Africa and, let's say, the gray areas of the world where states are failing and we have very little diplomatic interest, they actually have people on the ground there much more than the CIA does. They were able to do a much better investigation of this, and they've been very supportive of me. So it's not an entirely bleak picture there.
Right. Maybe Rummy will save us. Well, we've come to the end, and I'm going to ask you the question. Was the 9/11 Commission wrong?
They were dead wrong. They approached the question as a simple intelligence question, got the answer from the intelligence community, and didn't want to go any further. For time limitations, for lack of interest, I don't know. But they were dead wrong in what they concluded, and I think if they had a chance to go back and do it again and really look at the evidence, they might change their mind.
Doug Farah, thanks for...
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thanks for coming by.
Pleasure.
Author of Blood from Stones. Right. Diamonds, stones, we're talking about. And thank you for coming by. And come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.